Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Nick Pignataro. This is the Strath High School Symphony Orchestra and String Orchestra. This is the first time that our orchestra has been on this stage in concert in more than 2 years. We're back here to theme this night, which is sound. And you might say, well, sound is of course what music is all about. But in a special way, we're an orchestra again. We're a choir again. We're a music class again. The very act of playing an instrument and singing a note and having that sound vibrate and go from one person to the ears, the mind, and the heart of the person next to them is unparalleled in person. We cannot do that. We cannot teach the sound via the computer. It's just not possible for us. So everything we explore tonight is all about synchronous live sound. We're so grateful to all of you who have braved the pandemic to be with us this evening. We're so grateful for all of you around the world who are watching via live stream. Thank you in particular to two people who have made publicity and this live stream possible. The live stream, thank you so much to Miss Kate Plows, who's in the back making sure we look and sound fabulous. In addition, many of you know when things start and end around here is thanks to Mrs. Deirdre Abrahamson, who handles all of our public relations. Thank you to you. The first instrument is Felix Mendelssohn's Fifth Symphony, nicknamed the Reformation Symphony, partly because it uses a hymn written by Martin Luther, A Mighty Fortress is Our God, which is the Reformation hymn, the hymn that celebrates the Protestant churches leaving the Catholic Church during the Reformation. And Felix Mendelssohn would have been heavily influenced by the music we play at the end of tonight's concert, which is Beethoven's Symphony No. 9. Musicologists have called this the anxiety of influence. The idea that Beethoven's work, Beethoven's symphony, was just so incredibly groundbreaking that everyone that followed was either intimidated by Beethoven's Ninth Symphony or echoed, did it in the same way. So we get Felix Mendelssohn using a chorale, a singable song, just like the Ninth Symphony did for Beethoven, albeit a different song. We turn now to the music of the classical world by Joseph de Bologna, the Chevalier de Saint George. Bologna, he's a contemporary of Mozart, who's slightly older than Mozart. His music sounds very much like Mozart. He was born in Haiti and was the son of the plantation owner in Haiti, and also his mother was a slave. Fortunately for us, the father recognized him as his own son and sent him to Paris to learn to be a professional composer, a virtuosic violinist, and a professional fencer. Fences? Person who fences. Was actually at the ire of Mozart, perhaps because he was a little bit older, but his music sounds really good. And almost a little bit better than Mozart, and Mozart would have loved this too. His nickname was a racist one, and it was the Mozart Noir, that he was the black Mozart, the black version of Mozart being someone who was not quite as good as Mozart because of the color of his skin. Likely, that could be a reason that throughout history he hasn't been performed until very recently, where orchestras and conductors are pulling his music from obscurity and playing it again. So we hope you enjoy the first movement of his first symphony, Symphony No. 1 in G major, Joseph de Bologna. This is Allegro, with the strings of the symphony. Thank you. The music of Yukiko Nishimura reminds us of another possibility of modern orchestra, and that is to create a soundscape. The Horizon is a piece that she tells us is about assuming, literally viewing the sky and moving through clouds. Yukiko Nishimura is a pretty prolific composer for professional and student orchestras. She was originally born in Japan, studied in Japan, and has come to the United States to compose and to write and to study. This is Yukiko Nishimura's The Horizon.
Thank you.
We've braved the pandemic to continue the arts here, to continue this orchestra experience, and to have this concert, and for that we're extremely grateful, first and foremost, to our students for being on the stage this evening. They've survived online orchestra. And as terrible of an experience as that could have been for them, they also had families that were forcing them to continue when they weren't there. It takes all of us to make our students do what it is that we think they should be doing. And it takes them in order to do this. So I'm extremely grateful to our students and to our families that have made this possible, have allowed this orchestra to continue in full size with no loss of students after the pandemic, ensuring my job for another couple of years. Thank you for that. For the folks who are the folks who have made this possible, who keep us safe regularly, all the teachers, administrators, and staff at our buildings, there's so much work that goes on to make a masked, tuned up, mid-COVID pandemic thing happen. And I thank all of you so much. In particular, we thank our board of school directors, our superintendent, Dr. Wagner Marseille, and our building principals, particularly Dr. Greg Hilden, Mrs. Andrew Lapira, Mr. Tom McLaughlin, and Mrs. Tabitha Duffy. To all of those people, and to all the music faculty and all the teachers, they're making this possible for us, and we appreciate them. Another person in particular who is literally the glue of our music department, who back in April of 2020 demanded that all of us music teachers start thinking of ways to keep this program going because he saw what was coming, and this was Mr. Henry Proberg. So thank you to Mr. Proberg for keeping us all going, all of us alive. Thank you to all of you for being here. This has been a fabulous night. We have one final piece. Before I tell you that, there are some of you that have ordered these lovely poinsettias here. If you're an orchestra parent and you've ordered one of these plants, you can come and collect it after this portion of the concert, and we'll just let the chorus go on without any sort of decoration. So what I'm suggesting is if you want to come get it tomorrow instead of today so that the poor singers have something to you know. But you are, I will not call you out if you come collect your plant today. This final piece on our program is Beethoven's Symphony No. 9, at least an arrangement, some extractions from it. It needs no introduction from me. My most inspired, my perhaps famous favorite musician, composer, conductor, activist of all time, Leonard Bernstein, spoke often about the music of Beethoven. So I'll leave you with his words before we end tonight's concert with an Oats Joy Festival, which is extractions from the Ninth Symphony.
This music is not only infinitely durable, but perhaps the closest music has ever come to universality. That dubious cliche about music being the universal language almost comes true with Beethoven. No composer has ever lived who speaks so directly to so many people, to young and old, educated and ignorant, amateur and professional, sophisticated, naive, and to all these people of all classes, nationalities, and racial backgrounds, this music speaks a universality of thought, of human brotherhood, freedom, and love. In this Ninth Symphony, for example, where Beethoven has set Schiller's Ode to Joy in the finale, the music goes so far beyond the poem. It gives far greater dimension, vital energy, and artistic sparks to these quaint old lines of Schiller. Alle Menschen werden drin hol, men become brothers. Seiten schlungen Millionen hoi, millions embrace ye. Honest to den Schöpfer Welt, O world, you sense your creator. In other words, this music succeeds even with those people for whom organized religion fails. because it conveys a spirit of Godhead and sublimity in the freest and least doctrinaire way that was typical of Beethoven. It has a purity and directness of communication which never becomes banal. It's accessible without being ordinary. This is the magic that no amount of talk can explain. But perhaps there was in Beethoven the man, a child inside that never grew up, but to the end of his life remained a creature of grace and innocence and trust, even in his moments of greatest despair. And that innocent spirit speaks to us of hope and future and immortality, and it's for that reason that we love his music now more than ever before. In this time of world agony and hopelessness and helplessness, we love his music and we need it. As despairing as we may be, we cannot listen to this Ninth Symphony without emerging from it changed, enriched, encouraged. And to the man who could give the world so precious a gift as this, no honor can be too great, and no celebration joyful enough.
And it's the first time that the art of the 16th century is showing pain and suffering in the paintings. And Lotti captures the same pain and suffering through his use of dissonances, such as crucifixus. And again, you'll hear sopranos singing the word passus, which means suffer. And then you just, all these crunches between each of the voices. It starts off with crunches, these dissonances and the pain and the suffering of the crucifixion and the pain and suffering, again, pulling out the incredible artwork of Lotti, I mean, the music of Lotti, tying in with Caravaggio's paintings. So crucifixus Lotti. This piece is entitled Alleluia. Soloists for Alleluia are Natalie Caputo, Ella Grossman, and Charlie Shankweiler. solo in this, and they don't know who's singing it yet. So Sammy Quinn, who's singing the solo. So she's found out now. So I had all these people that sang. I'm like, I'll let you know at the concert. So Sammy Quinn, you ready?
Sure.
This is a wonderful English singer, Kate Rusby. Great arrangement by Voltius 8, Underneath the Stars.
Oh,
special to have somebody of his ability to work with us. I feel really honored to call him a friend and a colleague. So thank you, Mark. And very intellectual movie, City Slickers. Tumbling Tumbleweed is what I used to listen to when I was probably 6 or 7. My mom had her aunts, my aunts and her cousins and uncles over on Tuesday nights, and my bedroom was right above the music room. And I would listen to them and fall asleep to all this music. And this one is just, it's like, it's about being out west and, you know, the life of the tumbleweed. And it's, we wanted to make, you know, the girl, like, we should have cowboy hats and cowboy boots. So close your eyes, have fun sitting around the, you know, the campfire. It's all also in the movie, the Big Lebowski. It's in the beginning of that. You'll recognize the tune. And again, it takes me back to my childhood. Again, in the beginning of the year, just to get back into singing and get back into sort of vocal work, I split the sopranos and altos into sectionals and tenors and basses. And I figured, hey, let's sing these pieces in the concert. So that's why we're doing it. Tenors and basses, move up. Sopranos and altos. Beautiful lullaby. What's more beautiful than a lullaby? Swogon. Incredible song of fellowship, this next song. The soloist is Ben Ketson. Let every good fellow now join in that song.
Vive la compagnie!
Success to each other and pass it along.
Vive la compagnie!
Vive la, vive la, vive la. Vive la, vive l'amour, vive l'amour, vive l'amour, vive la compagnie.
Come all you good fellows and join in with me.
Vive la compagnie.
And raise up your voices in close harmony.
Vive la compagnie.
Vive la, vive la, vive l'amour, vive la, vive la, vive l'amour, vive l'amour, vive l'amour, vive la compagnie.
Should time or occasion come tell us to part,
vive la compagnie.
These days are forever in life and the heart.
Let every old bachelor fill up his glass.
Vive la, vive la compagnie.
And drink to the health of his favorite last.
Vive la.
from the Bach Magnificat Sicutlo Cutius Est. After a series of incredible solos, the choir basically says it's praises for all the good wishes that is coming to Abraham and his.
Thank you.
about comfort. It's about remembering where you came from. Beautiful poetry, beautiful Southern harmony, melody harmonized by Stephen Pauls. The Road Home. So we're going to do a little bit out of order, suggested by the choir. Give me your tired, your voice. Your huddled masses yearning to breathe. It is on a plaque on the Statue of Liberty. And I think it speaks for itself, the true meaning of liberty, and this poem that is on a monument that means so much. And I feel that we're in a time where sometimes we ignore sometimes those words, which mean the most. look at the lyrics, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free. The wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these. Those are the things that this country was founded on. No one's perfect. We're not perfect, but I think we need to live by these words. This piece is a piece that if we wouldn't be in this world, we would be up in New York City on the first weekend of October. The freshmen got a chance to sing at the Earth Mass at St. John the Divine. Then there was a fire. Then there was COVID. And so I figured, you know, we have to at least, you know, corporate memory, have the freshmen help, this year's seniors, help some of us, help us learn some of this music. This is one of my favorite from that Mass, Canticle of Brother Sun. Again, the whole Mass is basically based on animal sounds. There's a wolf that sets up the Kyrie. There's the whale calls that set up the Sanctus. And in the Cathedral of St. John the Divine, it is pretty incredible. We can just keep our fingers crossed that we come back to some semblance of normality. And next October, we'll be up there. So Canticle of Brother Sun, for the beauty of the earth. St. Francis, probably the first environmentalist.
Thank you.
and let's keep each other safe. Unbelievable connection between William Dawson and Philadelphia. William Dawson, Stokowski, and the Philadelphia Orchestra premiered at Carnegie Hall William Dawson's symphony. That was the only one he wrote back in the 30s, late 30s, and I conduct a group in the Philadelphia called the Orpheus Club, and that was a connection between Dawson and all of his amazing arrangements of the American spirituals. And his symphony was the American Spiritual Symphony. Look it up, listen to it, it is incredible. It's a sort of a symphony that disappeared, and again, the connection between Dawson and Philadelphia is pretty amazing, and this is one of his great spirituals. Ain't it that good news?